Comparable Worth versus Private Enterprise. Please join me in welcoming Mrs. Phyllis Schlafly.
Thank you very much, dear friends. I really appreciate that warm welcome, even before I have had anything to say. That's very kind of you. There's a new book out by Martin Anderson on what's wrong with colleges and universities. And he has great good things to say about the community colleges across the country. He says you get more for your education dollar at community colleges than you do at some of the great state universities. So I'm very happy to be here talking to students and friends. Thank you for asking me. The topic that was assigned to me is comparable worth versus the private enterprise system. And that is indeed a very interesting topic. It addresses the question, what do you think you're worth in the job that you are doing? Now, just in the last 10 days, we've had a very real demonstration nationally of how the worth of a job is a very subjective concept. It's a matter of how you think about it. So we had President Clinton's appointee for Attorney General, Zoe Baird, a lawyer who was earning a salary of nearly $10,000 a week. Her total salary was $507,000 a year. And she hired somebody to take care of her only baby. And she paid this woman $250 a week, which is 1/140th, or put another way, only 2.5% of what she was earning as a lawyer. Now, I just suspect that there might be other people who might think that lawyers are not worth 40 times more than taking care of a new baby. So I offer this as a subjective statement. That's what she thought. That's the way she thought things ought to be. I mean, that is a viewpoint, clearly. I was invited a few years ago to be a guest on the Sally Jesse Raphael show, and the topic was comparable worth. So Sally Jesse Raphael tried to set the stage for this topic at the beginning and tried to explain what it is. And then she said to this audience of all women, how many of you have held a job at one time or another, and practically all of them put up their hands. And then she said, and how many of you felt you were discriminated against? Two women put up their hands. So she rushed over with the microphone and stuck it in her face and said, tell me all about this discrimination. And this woman said, well, my boss got much more money than I did, and I think I worked harder than he did. Now, again, this is your point of view. I suppose that most of the people I know think they are worth more than they are being paid. In fact, I suspect that a lot of you will never be paid what you think you're worth. Most people think they're worth more, unless perhaps you're Gloria Steinem, who didn't have enough self-esteem. So she's written a book about how she didn't have any self-esteem. Where did this concept come from, and what does it mean? Well, it came out of the feminist movement. Initially, the feminists started out saying that they wanted men and women treated absolutely equally in all things. They wanted to deprive you of your right to make any difference of treatment, anytime, any place, on account of gender. I've been battling them since the 1970s, and their favorite expression was they want a gender-neutral society. They want us to be gender blind. So we had this whole series of equal pay for equal work laws. employment laws that prohibit discrimination on account of sex in hiring, in pay, and in promotions. We set up a whole government agency to deal with violations because, of course, no law is ever perfectly obeyed, and they had to have a process for dealing with the law violators. And indeed, this brought multi-million dollar judgments against some of the biggest companies in our land, such as AT&T, when their lawyers went into court and proved that they had discriminated on account of sex. So as a result of that, at last count, we have about 3,000 female coal miners in the country, and there are some women who got jobs climbing telephone poles and in these hitherto men's jobs. But as the years went on, the feminists discovered that there still were a lot of jobs that had more women in them or more men in them. So the feminist movement kind of got divided. Do we want a gender-neutral society in which you pretend that there isn't any difference between men and women? Or do you want to run to Big Brother government and have him give special preferential treatment to women? So these are the two points of view. And some of their goals are contradictory on this point. Comparable worth, it clearly comes from the point of view that the women want preferential treatment. What they want the government to do is to find out which jobs are held mostly by men and mostly by women, and then decide that this is discrimination because the women are not being paid what they're really worth, and therefore get the government to raise the pay of the women while they freeze the pay of the men. That's what comparable worth is all about. Now, if you observe life around you, and sometimes I think they don't, but you observe life around you, you see that men do take a lot of outside risky jobs that women just try to avoid. There are six times as many men as women who are injured at work. There are twice as many men who die accidentally. Women somehow seem to prefer the indoor climate-controlled offices. But the notion of comparable worth is they want to get the same pay as though they had chosen the jobs that men have chosen. But we still find that 99% of the plumbers are men. We still find that 96% of the engineers are men. We still find that 88% of the PhDs in math and science are men. And so the feminists keep nagging the government to come along and say, you've got to pay the women who choose other jobs, even though they don't take those jobs. Now, just telling you where I'm coming from, I believe in equal pay for equal work. But I certainly do not believe in equal pay for unequal work. And I think when you go to make a judgment as to whether one job is worth more than another when they are obviously not the same jobs, it is bound to be a subjective judgment. Washington State is the area where the feminists got the farthest with their idea of comparable worth. And they got all their friends on these evaluating survey teams, and they came up with the conclusion that nurses ought to be paid three times what electricians are paid and 10 times what truck drivers are paid. Now, how did they come out to that conclusion? Well, they said the mental demands on a nurse are entitled to 122 points. The mental demands on an electrician were entitled to only 30 points. And the mental demands on a truck driver were entitled to only 10 points. And I think it's pretty obvious that what they did was to pack the survey teams with their people, and they didn't ask the electrician and the truck drivers what they thought they were worth. In Illinois, they had their group try to get the secretaries paid the same as the prison guards. Now, you can see in a contrast like this how the whole idea is self-defeating. Because if you raise the pay of the secretary to be the same as the truck, as the prison guard, and you offer the job out there, I'll bet you 999 women out of 1,000 would pick the job of the secretary rather than the prison guard. So it's a pretty nutty idea, really, and the courts have treated it that way. When they brought their lawsuits, which they have with very powerful backing by some people, their cases have all been thrown out of court. It really doesn't make any sense. And I think the more you talk about this subject, the more you realize that their whole concept depends on getting their people in governmental jobs in order to achieve their result. I went down and testified against their comparable worth bill in Washington a few years ago, and told how it depended on getting their people as evaluators and commissioners and bureaucrats to make these wage changes. And I referred to the commissioners as commissars, and one of the senators didn't like it when I said commissars. What do you mean by that, Mrs. Schlafly? And I said, well, that means a governmental agent who makes his decisions based on his political view rather than what is just. And in the two bills that were presented in the Congress at that time, they had it rigged so that on one bill, 6 out of 11 of the commissioners were guaranteed to be people already committed to the idea of comparable worth. And in the other one, 5 out of 9 were already committed to comparable worth. But don't you believe in evaluation? Well, evaluators are just like lawyers. You hire them to produce the result and plead your case. That's exactly what they are. And the whole notion is simply not compatible with the private enterprise system because it depends in the last analysis on government wage control. The feminists simply refuse to look at the differences in behavior between men and women. What they try to do is compare the wage scale of all women with the wages of all men. Now, that doesn't tell you anything about discrimination. Factored into that are the different choices that women make. And the reason that all women do not earn in the marketplace the same as all men is that 30 years ago, the talented, successful women with 2 degrees like myself went into another occupation, raising our children. And that doesn't establish a wage in the marketplace. And they don't recognize the fact that women are 9 times more apt to leave their job than men, that the average woman has been on her present job only 1/2 as long as the average man, and that women just avoid the risky jobs that men do take. And then they'll come back and they say, well, we've tested it out based on numbers of years in college. Well, that doesn't mean anything. Now, in my family, my husband has given all of our children the same line. When you go to college, take engineering. You get more for your education dollar, and you learn things that are true. You don't learn things that are not true. Well, our sons took that good advice and graduated in engineering. Our daughters rejected that advice, and they wouldn't do it. If you've checked the wage statistics, you know that the engineer coming out of college can command a salary $10,000 more than the liberal arts graduate. Now, that's the way the marketplace is, and it has nothing to do with your number of years in college or whether you're male or female. There are lots of differences between men and women that the feminists don't like to recognize. Rich men are fatter than poor men, but rich women are thinner than poor women. This is a difference. I mean, that's the way it is. You look, men are 10 times more apt to be colorblind than women. 93% of the persons who have anorexia are women. So they're just these differences between men and women that the feminists don't want to recognize. But comparable worth is one of their efforts to have the government give preferential pay to women, even though they are not doing the same job. Now, they had another push called unisex insurance. Now, this comes out of their effort to force everybody to treat men and women the same. If any of you have had sons and daughters who got their driver's license and for whom you had to pay their automobile accident insurance between the time they were 16 and 25 years old, you know the enormous difference between what you pay on males and what you pay on females. It is a fact of our life that young men are apt to take more risks, they have more accidents, they drive faster in cars, and this is reflected in the automobile accident insurance rates that you pay. Now, as one of Eleanor Smeal's big efforts was to get the Congress to pass unisex insurance, So to force the insurance companies to pretend that there's no difference between men and women and to charge the same. It just didn't make sense to the congressman or to anybody else that this was to be a great advance for women's rights if you force the young women to pay more to drive a car than they are now paying. The feminists, back to their other line of trying to get preferential treatment, when they discovered that equal pay for equal work did not get them the same numbers of women in all the important jobs as men, they went gung-ho for affirmative action quotas. Now, quota is kind of a scare word, I guess, and nobody likes to admit that he's for quotas. But when we discuss the subject of affirmative action, it's always statistically presented. So if you're saying there's only 10% women in this job, what are you asking for? You obviously are asking for a quota. I would suggest that affirmative action for women is fundamentally unjust. Take, for example, the matter that for many years in this country, women did not have the right to vote. Do you think in order to compensate for that past injustice, we should now give women two votes? I think not. Maybe the feminists would like that. But I think most people can understand that that would be a wrong approach. And what is fundamentally unjust about affirmative action is that the remedy it offers and the benefit that it offers goes to a woman who was never the subject of discrimination. In other words, if you gave women two votes today, they were not women who were ever discriminated against by being denied the right to vote. And that is true in other areas too. It's the one who's getting the benefit on affirmative action is not the one who was discriminated against. I believe that when you've been wronged, you're entitled to a remedy, but somebody else isn't entitled to that remedy. And that is what affirmative action does. And naturally, it causes all kinds of resentments in the labor force. One of the big areas where the feminists have demanded and gotten affirmative action is in the military. And this is a case in itself. You see, they started out by saying, we want the women to go into the military just like men. If you understand the feminist ideology and their desire for a gender-neutral society, they have got to make the attack on the military because that is the real cutting edge of the differences between men and women. That is the area where the differences are obvious and where they could be a matter of life and death and where most people recognize them. We have a selective service law, a draft registration law that says that male citizens age 18 have to register. And no woman has ever been required to register. There is that difference. We've had laws that specifically exempted women from military combat. Now, the feminists have been after repealing these laws for 20 years in order to restructure society according to their view of it. So they got a lot of women in the military, and I suppose they discovered that they couldn't keep up with the men in a lot of areas. Initially, they started doing basic training together, and they found that didn't work. So they've had to fall back basically on affirmative action. In order to keep the women at about 10% in the military. For a long time, they kept denying it and kept saying, you don't know what you're talking about. The women are doing all the same tests, and they're just doing fine. Every military spokesman who addressed the issue said the women are just performing well. We finally got the truth of the matter in the case involving Virginia Military Institute. Now, Virginia Military Institute, VMI, is a military school with a long tradition, and people who know say that the regimen there is a good deal tougher than it is at the U.S. military academies. The first day you show up at VMI, they shave your head, and they call you Brother Rat, and you have absolutely no privacy of any kind, and you're really kind of treated like Brother Rat. That's why they call him that. Well, the feminists decided they wanted to break down VMI, and they didn't really have a woman who wanted to go to VMI. I don't believe there is a woman who wants to have her head shaved and be called Brother Red. But they cooked up what I feel was essentially a phony case, and they filed suit. And, of course, they got the Justice Department to go along with them, who caved in when the feminists made their demands. And they had this case. But in the American legal system, we have a wonderful system called cross-examination. Well, the people who were pushing getting women in VMI called down some officer from West Point to testify how well women are doing at West Point. And he did testify to that. And then under cross-examination, we got the truth. And what we found out is, yes, the women take a lot of the same tests as men, but they're scored differently. This is the technique called gender norming. And they may think they're taking the same test, but a certain performance that a man would get a C on, the woman would get an A on. We found out that essentially the women at West Point do not compete against the men at all. They compete against other women for designated female slots. And this is true in admissions, it's true in the way they're treated at the military academy, and it's true in assignment after they graduate. He testified how the training has been changed to accommodate the female cadets. They've simply eliminated a lot of the challenges that need upper body strength. They've made the rifle lighter weight. They've eliminated a forced march carrying a heavy pack. So this is what has happened, and it is an example of how the women don't want to compete equally, in fact, cannot compete equally. And they've built this facade of pretending that at the same time that they have had the benefit of special preferential treatment in order to give them the same scores that the men were getting. We find that one aspect of this is the way pregnancy is treated in the Army. Now, anybody with common sense, you'd think that a pregnant woman has got no place in the armed services. I mean, after all, what's the purpose of the armed services? It's to defend our country in battle. What's a pregnant woman going to do when you go into battle? But the feminists so intimidated the people running the military that they did not dismiss women who got pregnant. They let them stay on. They gave them light duty. Other men had to do their work and all kinds of pampered treatment. And then we find when the ship, the Acadia, docked at San Diego a couple of years ago, 36 of the crew persons were pregnant. And when the Yellowstone docked at San Diego, 20 were pregnant. And they asked the commander about this, and he said, those women had a right to get pregnant. And I think most people would think this is pretty ridiculous. It certainly is preferential treatment of the women who are pregnant and does nothing for our combat readiness. Then there's the matter of motherhood itself. Now, what's going to happen to the baby after she has the mother? Now, you must understand that it's feminist ideology that having a baby is just a temporary disability like breaking a leg. You know, you break a leg, you're in a cast for 6 weeks, and then you're back on the job. And their idea is that you have a baby after 6 weeks, it's your temporary disability's over, you're back on the job. And this is how it happened that during this recent Gulf War, women, service women, were sent over to fight the Iraqis who had had a baby just 6, 8, 10 weeks earlier and were still nursing them. Now, what in the world is the danger for our country that it required this type of a sacrifice on the part of those babies and those women? And you'll have people say, well, they signed up. They should have known. Somebody should have told those women that if they're signing up, if they're electing to stay in after they get pregnant, they might be shipped out to defend our country in some way. But that's the result of the feminists hammering away at the military for preferential treatment. Another thing that came out in the Virginia Military Institute case was that no free speech is allowed on the part of the cadets or any of the men at West Point on the subject of women's performance. The female cadets are allowed to correct their superiors if they say chairman instead of chairperson, but the men are not permitted to make any negative statement about the women's performance, or that will be a black mark on their record. We've had this recent debate about whether or not the combat laws should be repealed. Well, the commission that was set up to study this took a survey of the women on active duty, and they found that 75% of them said they would like the option to sign up for combat, but only 12% of them would volunteer. Well, you really can't say, you know, now we're marching forward to greet the enemy. How many of you are volunteering to go? I mean, when you're in the Army, you go where you're sent, and that's it. But another interesting result of this survey was that 81% said the Army should have different physical qualifications for men and women, and 52% said they would quit the Army if they had to meet the same qualifications as men. Back to the civilian labor force, the latest effort of the feminists is to talk about something called glass ceiling. Now, glass ceiling is the feminist code word for quotas for women in professional and management positions. Now, the feminist movement has no interest in the factory woman, in the blue-collar woman, and the blue-collar woman has no interest in the feminist movement. Its feeling is mutual. But the feminists are people who think they all ought to be General Motors vice presidents or TV station managers or high-priced lawyer and that sort. And they have developed this notion that the men are in a great giant conspiracy against them. And there is this thing called the glass ceiling that only they can see, nobody else can see, that they keep bumping up against when they're going up the career ladder in a big corporation. Of course, they don't accept the notion that maybe women have made other choices. A lot of them have taken time off to look after their children. A lot of them don't care to work the 60, 70 hours a week that it takes to rise to the top in a corporation. So the feminists look to government to solve their problems for them. And they've gotten the government, the Labor Department, to set up commissions and conduct studies and make findings in order to eliminate what they call artificial barriers. But the basic barrier is not artificial, it's real. It's that while there are some women who are willing to put the single-mindedness and the long hours and the nights and the weekends to build a career in the labor force, and I say more power to them, the majority of women don't seem to make that choice. The majority of women seem to want to take time for their family and children, and that is not the way you get to be the head of a big corporation. The pollster Yankelovich recently discovered on one of his surveys that 56% of women in the paid labor force would quit their jobs permanently if money were not a factor. And then Robert Half, who is a placement agency for management-type women, said that 82% of professional career women would choose a career with flexible hours, more family time, and slower career advancement rather than the fast track. These apparently are gender differences between men and women. But we have these feminists coming along trying to lay a guilt trip on the men and wanting to get the government to order them to be hired, promoted, and paid at a higher rate. One of their big pushes at the present time is the bill that is called the Family Leave Bill. And just in the last week, President Clinton has said this is going to be one of his first items of business. This bill was passed several times before and vetoed by President Bush, but they think they have the votes now to pass it. Now, this is a bill that is would require employers to give an employee I think it's 12 or 16 weeks of unpaid family leave for a new baby, an adoption, some family illness or emergency at the employee's request and direction. The employer would have to continue the health benefits during this period and keep the job open for this person who is no longer there. This is a one-size-fits-all type of legislation. In Greek mythology, there was a character named Procrustes who really invented the one-size-fits-all mentality. He was a kind of a vicious man who would capture travelers and put them on an iron bed. And if their legs were too long for the bed, he would just amputate them to the right length. And if the legs were too short, he had some kind of instrument that would stretch them out. And that's the one-size-fits-all mentality. And that's what this family leave bill is designed for. It is not designed to give mothers more time with their children. It is designed to get women back in the workforce just as fast as they can after having a baby. But the fundamental thing that's wrong with this is the whole idea of Congress telling the business employer who should hold the job. Here you've got these congressmen who are overpaid, overperked. Most of them could not possibly earn $120,000 a year in the private sector. Didn't earn that before they left. Most of them never met a payroll, didn't run a business, can't run a bank, can't run a restaurant, can't run the post office, and they are deciding who the businessman should have in their job. Now, nobody owns a job. If you do your job, you're entitled to be paid and paid fairly. And if you don't do the job, you're not entitled to be paid. And you're not entitled to get benefits if you're not doing the job. There is no reason why Congress should decide who holds a particular job rather than the employer. Now let's take a couple of examples to see how this works. Look at employer A. He's got a bookkeeper. He's a little small business. He only has one bookkeeper. He's not General Motors, who if one bookkeeper takes off, they can bring in another. This is a little business. He's got one bookkeeper. She wants to take off 3 months in the spring, just the busiest time for a bookkeeper. He will have, according to this law, to hold that job open for her till she comes back, not knowing whether she's going to come back or not, because women have been known to change their minds. And he has to maintain her health plan while she's gone. So how does he deal with this? Any option for dealing with this is costly. He can impose more work on other employees. That's not very good for employee morale. Maybe there's some applicants who are around. They're qualified. They have just as good family reasons to want to have a job. There's no reason to assume that the present employee is somehow more worthy than somebody else who's been trying to work up to that job or who's been laid off by another company and is eager to have this job. And, of course, you always have tremendous loss of productivity when you're dealing with a temporary. But Congress wants to decide. Let's take another example of an employer who has 53 employees. Now, the threshold for this bill is 50 employees. If you have 50 employees, you're subject to the law. If you have 49, you're not. Now, let's say you got 53 employees. What is the sensible employer going to do? He's going to find a way to lay off three employees, so he only has 49, and he's not going to be subject to the law. That's just one of many ways that this bill will cost jobs. Now take an example of another employer. He's been getting ready to let a certain employee go because she's not very productive. She's not doing her job. But she comes to him and says, I want 3 months family leave. Well, now he doesn't dare let her go. He will be hit with a lawsuit. And these efforts by the feminists and others to hold the employer hostage, they are not about rights. They are not about discrimination. They are about blackmail. And that's what it is. They hire a lawyer. And what the lawyers will tell them is that unless this is going to cost you $1 million, in which case it might be worth fighting, settle, pay her off. And that's what it is. And the woman's lawyer gets his cut out of it. So that's what this bill is all about. And I don't know if there are enough congressmen to stand up against it, because it did pass Congress twice, and President Clinton has said he wants that right away. But I think this is one example of why we have this recession at the present time. Congress has put so many regulations on business that business doesn't want to hire more people. You see, Congress has discovered that people don't want to pay any more taxes. And so what they do is impose the costs on business and make them pay it, and the result is more unemployment. Now, the feminists have another tack that they're working on at the present time, and that's called sexual harassment. Now, this is a very interesting topic. And this, of course, came to the fore in the Clarence Thomas, Anita Hill TV soap opera that was on some months ago. This whole concept of what we heard about from Anita Hill and sexual harassment is an example of the feminists trying to have it both ways, which they always do. See, I've been debating these people for 20 years, and for 20 years they were saying, we want to be one of the boys. We want to go into military combat. We want to be in the firehouse and sleep there with the firemen. We want to go into the locker rooms like the sports announcers do, and where the athletes are walking around in their birthday suit. We want to be treated like one of the boys. And then along comes Anita Hill. Oh, poor little me. The government has got to protect me against some dirty talk in the office. And I think people reacted as they should have reacted to that. They just didn't believe it. And it is the feminists trying to have it both ways. And people think there is something that isn't quite right about that. The continuing attack on Clarence Thomas is really outrageous. He never touched her. There wasn't any evidence that she was able to produce. Her so-called corroborating witnesses never corroborated it. Clarence Thomas assisted her career all the way. And I think we come to the conclusion that it was an attack on Clarence Thomas because he was a conservative, pro-life black, and they just couldn't take it, and they were out to get him any way they could. In the American and English legal system, over centuries, we've developed something called the reasonable man standard, so that when you give a case to the jury can think, now, what would a reasonable man have done in this situation? And that's the way you judge the crime or the negligence. And then in this present time of non-sexist language, a lot of the law books are changing to the reasonable person standard. And I think we might be willing even to go along with the reasonable woman standard. But that's not what the feminists want. They want the unreasonable woman standard. They want the flexible woman standard so that the woman can decide the next day or the next year or 10 years later that she didn't like what the man did. And that's the way they use this tool. What they're really demanding with this sexual harassment line is protective labor legislation for women in the workforce, and they've come full circle because they were very much opposed to that 20 years ago. Then they said, if we only had a woman on the Judiciary Committee, Anita Hill would have been taken seriously. And so we were treated as a result of the Anita Hill episode to 1992 as the year of the woman. Well, now, I don't have any problem with women running for office. I've spent 30 years trying to get women to be active in politics, to run for office. I've run for office myself. It's fine. Personally, I care whether they're conservatives or liberals. I don't really care whether they're men or women. But anyway, they told us we've got to have the year of the woman. So as a result of the Year of the Woman, we've got one new female senator who kited 143 checks, and we've got another one who's a welfare cheat. Now, I don't blame all women for this. I don't believe in group guilt. I think sin is personal. But you remember, they told us we all should rejoice in the year of the woman, and I really don't think that most women are going to be very proud or take some kind of reflected glory in having these two women in the Senate. Now, one of these women comes from my state, and she has fast made herself not only a state, but a national embarrassment. Her name is Carol Moseley Braun, and she ran for office because she was so upset that Anita Hill's charges were not taken seriously. Well, she got elected. It was kind of a fluke. But anyway, she got herself elected. And three women on her staff made sexual harassment charges against her campaign manager, whose name is Cozy. I can't pronounce his last name, but his first name is Cozy. Whereupon she tooted off on a month's vacation on the Concord with her, this campaign manager, to whom she was paying $15,000 a month. And she really didn't take these sexual harassment charges seriously. So I think we learned from this that sexual harassment is a tool that the feminists can use when they want to, and it's a non-event if they don't want to use it. The Chicago stations have been having a lot of fun with Carol Moseley Braun playing some music for which the lyrics are, "I'm moving up, getting my piece of the pie." And that's really what it's all about. It's the people who want the high living that goes along with being in government. It's about power and about perks. And that's why a lot of us are concerned that in the Clinton administration, 13 of eight out of 18 cabinet officers are lawyers, in addition to President and Mrs. Clinton. So I think what we have is a takeover by the lawyers. I would conclude from this that feminism is not compatible with private enterprise. The feminists always run to Big Brother government to solve their problems, whether it's wage control, which they call comparable worth, whether it's affirmative action, which is really quotas, whether it's the family leave bill, whatever. They want government to do for them what they don't seem to be able to do for themselves. The reason we have had some hard times in the last few years has been because of the oppressive regulations that Congress has passed. Congressman Dick Armey figured out that just since 1989, $130 billion of new regulations have been imposed on small business in this country. And now we have the latest news out of Washington is that Hillary Clinton has been appointed the czar or czarina of healthcare. Now healthcare is admittedly probably the biggest problem, the biggest challenge of this administration. And in this position of running the healthcare, she will be working closely with her longtime close friend, Donna Shalala, who is the head of the enormous agency called Department of Health and Human Services. And like true feminists, they will always want something that is more government control. They've come up with a very deceptive piece of jargon to sell it to people, managed competition. And the use of the word competition in this connection is really a fraud, because in real competition, the consumer decides how and when and where to spend his money. But under managed competition, how it is spent and where it is spent will be decided by the politicians, by the insurance companies, and by the company managers. They will not be decided by the taxpayers or by the patients. There are all kinds of controversial issues that are tied up with the health care issue. It appears that the Clinton administration is moving toward a plan to force workers to pay taxes on the health benefits they are getting from their company plan. They want to set up a national health board to decide a basic health package for everybody in the country. This is as ridiculous as having a national automobile board to decide a basic car that all Americans should drive. It simply doesn't work. There are all kinds of controversial issues. Is the basic health package going to include abortion? Is it going to include long-term care for Alzheimer's? Is it going to include psychiatric care? Is it going to include dental care? What about treatment for drugs and alcohol? And I would guess that a lot of people would not care to wait in line for your hip or heart surgery so that drug addicts can get more treatment. But these are the kinds of things that are involved in a national health board making the decision about what is the basic care. The biggest thing that is the matter with the health area in this country is that those who are on company plans get to buy their health insurance with pre-tax dollars, whereas other people, self-employed, people who work for small companies who don't have health plans, have to first pay their taxes and then buy their health insurance after they have paid their taxes, which means, in effect, that they pay about twice as much. Now, the problem with having Hillary run this is, I ask the question, is she going to be treated like any other Clinton appointee? Is she going to be available to the press to answer questions, testify before Congress, take the heat like a man when all these issues come up? Or is she, like a feminist, going to try to have it both ways? And is it going to be, when the going gets tough, that Clinton will do like he did when Jerry Brown, in their debate, tried to raise the question about conflicts of interest with her law firm in Little Rock? Clinton said, "How dare you criticize my wife? You aren't fit to be on the same platform with her." So I think that's the way the feminists play the game. It isn't compatible with the private enterprise system, and I would suggest that the private enterprise system has done an awful lot for women. It has made life in this country such that people all over the world want to come here. You don't find people getting in boats to get out of the United States for some other land. They're all trying to come here. When I got married, the thing I wanted most in the world was a dryer to dry my the diapers. Now, nobody dries diapers anymore. They use paper diapers, and what all my young married friends want is a fax machine. So that tells you what the private enterprise system has done for what traditionally has been called women's work. Private enterprise is great. Let's not let the feminists and the socialists louse it up. Thank you.